I farm just outside of Redwood Falls, Minnesota. We grow corn, soybeans for seed, and this year we have some cereal rye. And I farm just over 1,000 acres. I've been farming since, I think about my junior year in college. So 2001 was my first crop year. I farm with my father and my grandfather. We kind of share labor, share equipment, but kind of make our own management decisions. My grandfather just turned 92. He helps out quite a bit. It's really fun to have three different generations working side by side. So, it's pretty cool. I am the fifth generation that's farmed some of the land that I farm. My grandfather and my grandmother own some of it. I rent from them and have bought some from them. So that land has been in the family for five generations, and it's pretty neat to look at it and see this has been going on for a long time. And that puts a lot of responsibility on me to make sure I manage this and take the best care of it for the next generation. So they did it with me in mind, and I'm doing it with my followers in mind. So what it means to me is somebody before me probably had the same mindset that we got to do what's best for the soil, what's best for the farm, what's good for our family with the information, the data they had. You know, moldboard plowing, that's what you do. That's the data they had. As we've progressed in the conservation practices, we've learned that that's maybe not the best thing, and we've adapted and we've changed as more and more stuff comes out and becomes available. It's important to me that, you know, I've got two young girls, and I don't know if they're going to be farmers, but if they are, or the next person that farms this land, they have the same potential to have a good lifestyle as a result of farming that ground, just like I had that same opportunity to have a really blessed, great life from the result of farming. So that to me is kind of the legacy and the concept and the idea that drives why we do what we do. So growing up as a farm kid, we've always grown seed soybeans for as long as I can remember. We've grown sweet corn or canning crops for Del Monte for many years. So we've always had these long relationships with these different companies. And that was kind of instilled in me early on that we work with somebody, we diversify a little bit and do things a little different than just commercial crops. With that comes a little more work. So walking soybeans, you know, riding on the bean bar, which instilled that work ethic, and really managing fields as a little more intense unit instead of, that's a field, we do this, we're done, we move on. And then watching my father and my grandfather be willing to adopt and change practices to, we were one of the first ones that had a disc ripper, and it was through an equip or a cost share program back in the mid 90s that we can get some money to change our tillage practice. I've witnessed that. In about 2015, we were in the disc ripper, chisel plow, field cultivator, conventional tillage practices. That's what we had been doing, and that's, like I said, that's kind of the latest, greatest. That's what we did. 2015, I kind of thought, you know, why are we doing it this way? And I'd read some about strip till, and boy, that makes sense that I can ban my fertilizer, put it in the strip. I'm only tilling, let's say we're in 30-inch row spacing, so if I make a 10-inch strip, I'm tilling a third of the field. Efficiency-wise, that makes sense, because I can do one pass and I'm done. So I started exploring that. I went to a few field days and went out to some stuff in Wahpeton area and saw some of what they're doing and realized, you know, there's farmers out here, actually up in the Red River Valley, that are already doing this. If it works there, why can't it work here? And I wanted somebody to come out and make some strips for me, but there's nobody that has it, so who's gonna do it? 2017, went and bought one myself, a used machine, and I thought it would fit what I wanted to do. We did a little bit 2017. We'd been using some vertical tillage after our sweet corn and corn after, 2014. So we had kind of gotten away from the disc ripping in 15, 16, and using a vertical tillage after corn. We really liked how that worked. And then this was just progressing into the strip till in 17. We did a little bit. 2018, the fall of 18, we strip tilled everything and ran the vertical till Got into the no-till in 2018. So that was a learning experience, and what I saw in the no-till in 18, before any yield data, in 2018 we had a lot of rain in season, lots of 3, 4, 5 inch rainfall events, and then 1 10.5 inch rainfall event that it doesn't matter what you're in, you're going to lose some crop. So just seeing after some of these 4 inch rainfall events, and that was the third year of no-till on those fields, how those fields handled water differently than the conventional tillage or the strip tillage, that really drove me to keep doing in that practice and seeing. In 19 we had too much water again, but those fields handled that water so much differently than the conventional till. So it's really fun to try different things and to see the differences. And we've had a great window to seed cover crops with the canning crops. After sweet corn in mid-August, we got a great window to get some covers seeded. And we grow early maturity stuff, 00 maturity, that last year we didn't get them planted until the middle of May, but I was still harvesting soybeans in the middle of September. This year we're going to harvest beans probably early September. So I've got a great window to get cover crops seeded there because they're off early. Not everybody has that opportunity in a commercial row crop farm. If you're growing stuff that's for this region, harvesting beans the end of September is a good time to start. Well, that limits your cover crop seeding window. So I kind of look at it as this is a great way to try some of this stuff that can help other people learn and for us see the benefits to it. But we started doing cover crops after sweet corn in 2014 was the first year we did it, and we really liked what we saw planting soybeans after the cereal rye cover crop in 15, and we've continued to do that and add more acres now. We've gotten rid of the conventional tillage for the most part. After soybeans, it gets strip-tilled for corn, except some of those fields that are no-till. Of my about 1,000 acres, 60% of it is strip-tilled no-till soybeans, 40% is continuous no-till. And the previous tenant and the landowners had entered into an equip contract for no-till, for a 3-year no-till contract. For whatever reason, the previous tenant stopped farming it after 2 years. So they had 1 year left on their no-till contract. And this was on about 400 acres. And I had just gotten a new planter with hydraulic down pressure and the clean sweeps and all the bells and whistles to no-till. So I thought, well, I think my planter can do that. So I no-tilled it. And the first year, it was 2018. I did some corn on corn just because I'm glutton for punishment. And soybeans into rye, they were in this no-till grazing cover crop rotation, and planted beans into rye, and I was fine with that. We'd been doing that already, so that's probably why I went the soybeans into the rye and the corn on corn, because I wasn't familiar with corn into green rye. I was a little nervous. That's in 2018. Now, I'd probably do it the other way. So no-till corn on corn was 120 bushels, and that's including the drown-out areas. So there was some that was really good. We had put some 150 pounds of pea down pre-plant, planned a side dress. Didn't get side dressed. I mean, it was too wet. I tried with Coulters and it just balled everything up. It just, all the corn residue, and it was wet and it all stuck in the Coulters and it just didn't work. And then it's too wet, and knowing what I know now, how that no-till soil carries, I probably could have Y-dropped it later and not gotten stuck. But there were people running four-wheel drives out to pull out the high boys to get the Y-drops out. I didn't want anything to do with that. So it got 150 pounds of pea. It went 120 corn on corn. Talking with the neighbor, conventional till, all the fertilizer up front, his corn was 120. And I thought, well, this train wreck of mine was just as good as his, with way less expense. You know, zero tillage, I put on 150 pounds of fertilizer. I didn't put on any DAP and potash because that's all on the surface. My corn roots aren't going to utilize that anyway. So it had 6 gallons of 1034-0 in furrow, and it was 120 versus your full nutrient removal rate or a building rate that a lot of people are doing for your P and K that are certainly more expensive than 6 gallons of 1034-0. So it has some merit to me, and so I've just continued with it. And looking at the soybean yields now at harvest, they're right with everybody else's. So 2019, we did it again here in 2020. I've made some changes on the fertilizer part, but 100% of it is either no-till or strip-till. The changes in the soils that we've noticed has been lack of erosion and lack of soil movement, along with higher infiltration rates, and the ability for soil to maintain and control traffic or compaction or wheel traffic or whatever you want to call it has been quite noticeable. And I think we're probably growing better crops without quite as many or quite as much input. Our soybeans, we don't really push the fertility on those for a lot of reasons, and we're growing really good soybeans. Now, utilizing the cover crops, minimizing tillage, and probably seeing a higher microbial activity, I believe is releasing some of the nutrients that our soil already has. We're blessed in a really great region here in southwestern Minnesota that has some really high organic matters just naturally from the history that our soils have had. Most fields average 4.5. We have some peat stuff that's over 9. We have some soils that are heavy, high organic matter in the 6s and 7s, our depressions. And there's a huge stockpile of available nutrients there if we can convert them and have them released. So, you know, our we'll call them eroded knolls. They're not really so bad compared to some parts, but organic matters in the, you know, mid-3s is kind of how those are. So my goal here is to add organic matter on there, change the soil to absorb and hold water on the hills. So on a, let's say, a 2 or 3 inch rainfall event, which we seem to get more of it stays there and less of it runs off to pond in the bottom. And that's gonna benefit my crops in both regions. On the hill, I have more water for that crop, and in the low spot, I have less water to try to manage. So the soil health benefits through minimizing tillage, cover crops, has changed our soil a lot in the fact that we can hold more water, but we stop soil movement. And that's really important to me.